Sai Ram to everybody, and thank you so much now for this opportunity. I'm not very good at preparing any of these things, and I always hope and pray that the divine speaks in the way that the divine can best. And so this time that I have with you, I'm just going to share a small snippet of my journey. I think each of us who's gathered here, we are here because there is a very, very powerful, profound energy, which at some point started to work in each of our lives. And because the energy pulled us, here we are, and each of us has our profound journey, which is ongoing on so many levels. I want to start from the period, really quickly, a little bit of background. Swami, I was very fortunate to have met him in 1985 when I was a school student, and we had an interview with Baba, after which I believe he totally changed the course of my life. And I didn't realize how profound his guidance was till these dreams started. And he would come and he would keep calling me, and I had not been to Parsi for 21 years. And eventually I landed up there and everything sort of changed after that. But what I want to share today is more about what happened to me post when Swami left his body. Because as long as he was in his physical body, we are like children, you know. We used to run to him. Any problem, any issue, go to Parsi, it will be taken care of. And almost always, it was taken care of. His love was like a mother, a doting mother, that before you ask anything, it would be given to you. And there was so much of love. But I used to always remember Swami's words. He used to say very prophetically that to whom more is given of them, more shall be asked. And this is something that used to be in one of the bookmarks I had picked up in Parsi, and it used to always stay in my books, the books I used to read. And it used to always sort of periodically remind me that your journey, while it is about your journey, it cannot be confined just to you. Swami's hand in my journey was really to open me up, to awaken me to the fact that life wasn't just what we thought, the world of the five senses, that there was so much more beyond. But in order to access, understand, and experience that, we had to be prepared, we had to be ready. And the most effortless, beautiful part of my journey was all those years, as long as he was in his physical body. And when he left that body, that was the time I could actually tangibly feel a cocoon of protection, a shield was removed, and I went into a free fall. This free fall is what I often refer to as the dark night of the soul. And anybody who's on the spiritual path will go through this periodically, varying levels of intensity. But what was really the struggle for me was that in the past, I could just go running to Parsi and Baba would be there and everything would be okay. And I had nowhere to run to this time. I wasn't strong enough to go to a Parsi where Swami was now in a Samadhi, and I wasn't evolved enough to be able to sense his presence without his physical form. That was my limitation. So there was a lot of struggle happening, and this was a time when my work, my health, my emotions, my body, everything began to fall apart. And his guidance used to come through not as regularly as before, but it would come through in those desperate times. And he would constantly say that if you don't learn to unlearn, you cannot move on. So there comes times in our life, in our life journeys, when we have to actually leave behind everything that has brought us to a point, and then maybe pick up new tools, new skills, new understandings, deeper understandings, and then move on. And so this was the time I feel that he was prepping not just me, so many of us, but it wasn't easy. The hand-holding was not there. And it reminds me very often, you know, as parents, when the child is small, you will hold the hand and you will, you know, make them cross the road, and you'll take them everywhere while you are sort of, you know, you've got them protected and you're, you know, holding on to them. But there comes a time where you have to release that hand if you want the child to grow, and you want the child to blossom, and you want the child to understand and realize his or her potential. For me, that was the period post 2011 when I feel that he left his hand, and I felt as if I had been left behind. But when I look back, it was his infinite love and grace that stepped back and allowed me to go through some very, very difficult learnings. In 2014, you know, I had an electrical issue in my heart. It had been giving me a lot of grief since 2012. And eventually, a series of events took me to Whitefield, and I had my surgical procedure there in Swami's wonderful super specialty hospital. I truly believe my life was given back to me by Bhagwan at that time. And he kept me there in Bangalore for a month after this procedure. And I used to always speak, even in those days, Swami's blessings were always there, that I used to be called to speak here and there. So I was, you know, talking to the doctors and the nurses in the hospital, to the Bal Vikas parents, and so on. So I used to try and do whatever little seva that I could. But there was this emptiness inside me, which was just growing and growing and growing, and I didn't know what to do and how to fill it. It was on one of those Thursdays that when I was in Whitefield, that I got this very clear kind of guidance from Swami, where he said, "Your Advaitic journey has begun." And I remember looking at a photograph which was hanging in front of me, which was just, you know, many of you would have seen it, just Swami's two eyes, and they were sort of looking into you, and the message was very, very clear. And I remember my heart sank at that point, because Dvait is so much easier, you know. A dualistic way of worshiping and connecting with the divine is so much easier, because it's you're praying to somebody outside of you, or even inside, but somebody that you know is more, it's greater than you, is so much more powerful, and all you have to do is become a child and, you know, beg, plead, ask, demand, and you have somebody who's responding. But when this entire journey begins to turn, the mirror begins to turn inwards, and now his guidance is that it's got to come back to you, you know that this is going to come with a far greater understanding, as well as a greater amount of responsibility to realize that you are that. And it takes me back to what Swami used to say regularly in the 60s and even after that. But I still remember, I think it was his 1968 Dashara speech, or one of those incredible speeches where he talked about the Sai Avatar. And he said it then, he said it so many times later. He said that, you know, very few of you really want what I have come here to give you. You know, you all come for the calling cards, the trinkets, jobs, promotion, marriage, this, that, and the other. But none of you really want what I have come to give you, which is to remind you that there is no difference between you and me, except that I know I am God and you have forgotten that. And so this message came through very, very strongly on that day. And instead of feeling elated, my heart felt very heavy, because I knew that this was going to be a journey unlike any other. You know, the journey back to yourself requires a complete reorientation of who you are, how you define yourself, how you operate, and also your external facing view of reality needs to become much more inward. So I went through this whole period of confusion and doubt and not knowing, you know, who to turn to, what to turn to. And it was God's grace that I was guided on to the next stage of my spiritual journey, and I met my guru, my current living guru, Sri M, whom some of you may know about. And When I met him, one of the first things he said is that Baba has guided a lot of his devotees now into the space. So it's going to be a different journey, but trust the journey. And that put me onto a path which has been deeply humbling. And the quote that I said about the sense of responsibility, to whom more is given, of them more shall be asked. I think the personal integrity in terms of our own Trikarna Shuddhi, something Swami used to always talk about, has become so much more amplified now. I find that in this phase of my life journey, and I'll come back to that analogy about the salt doll a little later, but in this phase of my journey, it's really about understanding myself. When I pray for the world also, it's with the humbling acknowledgement that unless I am not holding the vibration of peace within me, if I am not being peace in every relationship in my life, I have no business demanding or asking for peace in the world outside, because what I am, who I am, is what I'm going to manifest. So we wonder, there are so many good people working for world peace, you know, praying every day. There are groups, you know, chanting. There's so much happening. Why is it that the world seems to be getting more and more chaotic, more and more divided, more and more sort of, you know, disparate? The reason is whatever we see outside, and this goes back to another wonderful interview that Swami had given to John Hislop way back in the 70s. Where John asked Swami, he said, Swami, is it true that everything that we see around us, it's just a hologram? This is a holographic universe. And Swami said, yes, everything is a hologram, including me. And here is the thing about the hologram. If we take the hologram to be the absolute reality, we are making a huge mistake. The hologram is only a projection of that absolute inner core, which is within each of us. And if we don't realize that what we see outside is a projection, which is going through the impure filters or the pure filters of our own mind, our own consciousness, then we are actually missing the key to shifting and changing things. So these last few years of my life have been really about taking so much more ownership and responsibility, and maybe putting myself under a magnifying glass or a scanner constantly through the grace of Bhagwan and the Guru to see how much more impurity is there that I need to acknowledge and shed. How do I still operate, you know, in a separation mentality? Do I really think the other is separate from me? How is every thought, word, and action of mine? Is it an alignment? Is it not? And it's really interesting, you know, in the Upanishads, it's said very clearly, he who operates in the realm of separation dies a thousand deaths. And this is another very profound thing which has stayed in my mind. And it's a great reminder every day when I go through my day-to-day interactions with people. Do I see them as someone different from me? Because the truth is, we are all one consciousness, something Swami used to always talk about. We are just one consciousness. The divine is expressing itself through different points, through different aspects, through different ways, through diverse ways of showing that the expression of love, you know, for the divine to love itself, it needs all of these manifestations. So you are that, I am that, he is that, she is that, the maid servant is that, the car driver is that, the beggar on the street is that, the hungry dog is that, the flowers, the car, the skies, the cloud, the oceans, it's all that. And when this becomes a living experience for us, who can we hurt? Who can we harm? How can we take decisions if we are in positions of power, if we are in government, or if we are in, you know, bureaucratic positions? If we are in media, how can we take decisions which would harm another aspect of myself? This understanding, this experience, this humbling of the ego personality, which used to think that it was separate and sometimes even superior. These are the big traps we have to go through and we have to face when we are on a spiritual journey. It's only God's grace that the mirror is constantly shown in front of one's face so that one can just work on one's own inner purity. And this is the secret. If we purify, we work on purifying ourselves, which honestly is the only thing we are really in control of, well, control of with lots of grace, then if more and more of us do that, there will come a time when there will be such a tipping point in this holographic reality, in the consciousness that is manifesting outside, that we won't have to demand or fight for world peace. It will happen. It will manifest if each of us do the inner work. So the last bit is to do with the salt doll, because I promised to share that. So this is actually a story that Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa used to share. And Sri M often shares that. This is how the journey of the seeker is. Each of us, we are so married to our individual identities, which is similar to that of a salt doll. And the salt doll, thinking that it's a separate identity, is now in this ocean of existence, diving deep, thinking that it can actually measure the ocean's depth. What happens in the end? All of the salt in the doll just dissolves and we become the ocean. That is the invitation that Swami left for each of us. That is the guidance that he gives us. That is how he operates through that point in our hearts. That is why he never stopped reminding us that we are embodiments of love. We are embodiments of peace. And he said, in the last time that I was fortunate to sit in front of him and listen to him, it was the Makar Sankranti day in 2011, January, where he said in his final speech that I heard, he said, from now on, your life is my message. And I remember all of us were sitting there, you know, crying our hearts out. It was almost like he was handing over that responsibility to each of us. And so I think that's the only yardstick we need to measure our progress with in this journey called life. How are we doing? Are we embodying all that he asks us to, in thought, in word, and in action? Thank you so much, Jai Sai Ram. Om Sri Guru Pranamah.